Hello, and thank you for joining the first in a series of 6 monthly programs devoted to organ donation. It is really great to have you here as we talk to people throughout Berks County who have participated in the organ donation process in some way. My name is Elaine McDevitt. I am your host and a very fortunate organ recipient. I am both in awe and incredibly grateful for those who make the selfless decision to help save or even better the lives of individuals through organ donation. Our topic today is living donation. So this happens when a perfectly healthy living human being either has a friend or a loved one who needs an organ or part of an organ, and they can still donate and still keep their health. Or sometimes they even do it for people that they know, a friend, or sometimes they just do it because it's a very, it's the best part of humanity, really, to be able to do that. So thousands of lives are saved every year thanks to the unselfish generosity of living donation, which is an increasingly viable option for patients awaiting transplantation. Living donation offers advantages such as a shorter wait time and faster period of recovery for the recipient. Also, transplants from family members that are a strong genetic match to the transplant recipient decrease the risk of rejection, which is a big thing when you're in the organ donation process. While the majority of living donors are blood relatives, this is not a requirement. As I said, living donors can be a friend or even an altruistic stranger. So to start off my series today, I want to introduce to you my guest, Bala Peterson. He is an IT professional. He is the chairman of the board of the BCTV, and we appreciate all that that goes into that. He is a devoted husband, a devoted father, and he is a living donor. So, Bala, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you so much for having me, Elaine. I'm excited to be here.
Well, this is a very personal journey, and I don't know about you, but when I talk about it and hopefully encourage people to become part of the organ donation process, I feel like I'm sort of giving back. Mm-hmm. But you are a person that has given so much because, tell me how you came to be an organ donor.
Yeah. So in 2008, we found out that my mother needed a kidney. She was having kidney failure. She was right before the stage where she would need to go on dialysis. Mm-hmm. And so around the summer is when the process started. Mm-hmm. And so we got the call, and I knew that by the time my parents would reach out to me, it was probably very serious.
Now, do you have other brothers and sisters?
I do. I have 4 brothers. Yes.
And are you now your mother's favorite child? I'll bet so.
I think I was a favorite before the donut. I'm just kidding. Yes.
So your parents called. Your mother needed a transplant. They asked, could you please be tested? And then what happened?
Yeah, so it's a pretty straightforward process to see if you're a match. So for us, it was a blood test. And so my mother lives in Nigeria. So I took a blood sample, shipped it via DHL to the United Kingdom. The test was done, and I was a perfect match. Yeah.
A perfect match.
Perfect match.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. And then, how long was it before you took, they deemed you a perfect match? Yes. How long was it until the actual surgery happened?
So it was around the summer, I remember. Now, this was 13 years ago, so it's been a while. Mm-hmm. But around the summer, we found out the need. The testing happened around then. Mm-hmm. Then by October, we were traveling to start the process because the need was fairly urgent. So
now, has your relationship with your mother changed since you made this decision to offer one of your kidneys? Or was it wonderful then? It's wonderful now. How is it different?
It was wonderful then, and there is, we both share a scar. And we both share the process. And mm-hmm. So I feel it's a bond that the both of us have that no one on this planet understands. Mm-hmm. And so there's something just surreal about that. But I also feel really lucky and blessed to be able to give back to my mother. Because mm-hmm. if you met my mother, she's a fantastic woman. And she's thoughtful and kind and gentle. Uh-huh. And so it was obvious. Like, it was a no-brainer for me that mm-hmm. this was something I needed to do. There were a couple of things I needed to work through, but when the request came through, I felt the prompting in my spirit that I need to do this. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Well, I loved it when we were sort of doing a pre-interview on this subject, and you were saying how, Elaine, you would want to give your kidney to my mother. I mean,
she's awesome.
What a huge compliment that was.
She is awesome, yeah.
She's really fantastic. So you're saying that your mom and you share a scar together, but what is it like actually when you're with her or when you think about it? Here you have one of your vital organs yeah. keeping somebody else alive. Do you ever think about that, or did you think about it and now you don't because it's been a while? Or how does that work?
Well, so I obviously talked to my mom. She's doing very well today, 13 years later. Mm-hmm. She's in great shape. But when we talk, I try to make a point to let her know that I'm okay.
Okay.
This process has forced me to really pay attention to my health. Uh-huh. My children are gifts. Uh-huh. The time I have with my wife, it's a gift. Uh-huh. And so I think this donation process has really almost like turned on a light bulb of you have to value the time you have, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so also just being in awe of the process of medicine and doctors and science, mm-hmm. and this process also deepened my faith in God.
Oh, wow.
Because, mm-hmm. you know, the first thing, it was just, they're going to be taking an organ from my body mm-hmm. and transplanting it. Mm-hmm. And so part of this process, I did the research, right? Mm-hmm. Just to get comfortable. But the truth is, even though I know this was necessary, I wasn't excited to do it. Mm-hmm. I knew that.
Yeah, who's excited about going into the hospital and going through surgery, right?
And so once I was honest with myself that this is a gift that I get to give back to the woman who has given me everything. Mm-hmm. And also the second thing that I was really concerned about was the rejection process you mentioned in the beginning. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, that's the biggest worry for everyone. But for me, it was especially concerning because this is my mother.
Right.
We're going to go through this process, and if there's rejection, that would be devastating. Mm-hmm. And so, and just to be fully transparent, that's where my faith played a huge part. Mm-hmm. Because I felt that I just needed to do what was right. Mm-hmm. I needed to give the gift, and God will take care of the rest. Mm-hmm. And so once I got to that point of just understanding what my fear was, that rejection fear, mm-hmm. the donor rejection fear, and giving that to God, mm-hmm. then we could really settle into the process and just go through it, mm-hmm. you know? And so, you know, when I talk to my mom, people say I gave a gift, but I received something tremendous also. Without
yeah.
a doubt.
Oh my Without gosh. The yeah. gift of your mother is a huge gift. Yeah, I totally agree. Yeah. Did we, I'm not sure because I wasn't looking up at the monitor, but did we put a picture of Bala and his mom up? We already did? Okay, great. Yeah, I said to Bala when he sent me this, I said, are you sure that's your mother? I think it looks like you guys are brother and sister. Yeah. It's such a beautiful, happy picture. Was this taken around the time of the transplant or was it later?
This was right after.
Right after?
Actually, this was my brother was having a vow renewal, I think their 10-year wedding, and so we all met up. And so this was a celebration. And people were cooking in the background. Uh-huh. And so this moment was when we both started feeling great.
Oh, okay.
Physically.
Well, I think it shows on your faces, yeah.
yeah.
And also the love.
So
when obviously your focus was on, I'm gonna do this thing for my mom, she deserves it, I wanna do it. But what did the medical professionals tell you about what possible risks you could have as a donor?
Yeah. So there are many, many risks, right? But primarily as a donor, you can live with one kidney.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was a concern that went out pretty early for me.
Okay.
Rejection in the recipient
mm-hmm.
was another real one. They mentioned that emotionally, if you donate and the recipient has any kind of, you know, regression or they die, that it's a really heavy emotional weight and causes a lot of, you know, trauma for the
donor.
Well,
interesting that you would say that, because I had the pleasure of speaking with my donor's parents.
Mm.
And my donor was a hero to four. I was the recipient for his heart. I had, he donated both his kidneys and a liver.
Wow.
All the surgeries were successful. And then the one person who got the liver, he unfortunately got COVID and passed away.
Wow.
And she was telling me that it was really, really hard on them. And that was the first time I realized, wow, you know, I mean, we say we have, you know, our loved one is living within these different people. They're keeping him alive, da, 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 and it's all wonderful. But wow, you know, every time one of those people could possibly pass away, that must be very difficult.
Very difficult.
I can imagine as a donor, thinking about that in terms of your mother would be very difficult.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But the great thing is that the medical team prepares you for that.
Okay.
So where we had the surgery in India,
mm-hmm.
and so there was a team, and I'm sure it's similar here in the States as well.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not just the doctor, it's not just a nephrologist performing the procedure.
Mm-hmm.
You have someone who is kind of like not a psychologist or not a therapist.
We had a psychologist on my team.
Okay, mm-hmm. awesome. And so they will prepare you for this.
And also a nutritionist. Yeah, but a lot. It's a big group of different specialties. Yeah.
I remember like there were lots of doctors,
uh-huh.
and during the prep process, and they would ask, they would tell you things. The process is actually really remarkable. They can do kidney transplants,
laparoscopically.
That word, yes.
I can't believe that. That's incredible.
Yeah. They'll make incisions, you know, detach the kidney. So the process is really fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
The volume of kidney transplants that happens,
mm-hmm.
Where we had ours, they did the third number of transplants in the world.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, I felt very comfortable. I was not worried about the medical procedure.
Okay. And that's very important.
Yeah. Because it's such an advanced process, and the doctors did a fantastic job of answering all the questions, preparing us, and yeah, it felt pretty seamless going into it.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I would imagine here in the States, for anyone who's willing to be a living donor, physically, you don't notice a difference,
mm-hmm.
right? Like, physically, your body still functions.
You're actually the first living donor I've ever spoken to.
Wow.
And you had yours overseas, so the next time I speak with a living donor, I'm going to ask them that question.
Yeah.
But I'm sure that it was the same thing. I'm sure you had the same fears, the same comforts, the same, you know, basic experience, especially because you were at a very well-renowned hospital, you know, with top-notch.
Yeah, it was top-notch. And mm-hmm. so, you know, part of there's very little change in my life before and after, but one of the things they tell you about is just diet, right? So no complex proteins, no like those power shakes or things like that, but these are not like hindrances to living a full life.
Mm-hmm.
I still played sports afterwards. Yeah, all that, I don't notice much.
So you were married at the time and you had a baby on the way.
We had a baby on the way, yes.
And what did your wife think about all this? Was she supportive of you doing this? Because there are some risks, you know, there, or was she go for it, Bala?
My wife is tremendous.
Aww.
She is. And my wife knows my mother.
Mm-hmm.
My wife loves my mother.
Aww.
And so And my wife also knew, like with a baby on the way, this had to be very, very serious. Or else, like, this would not be a request.
Right, right.
And so we all shared the sense of urgency. And we all shared the, you know, that it would be a tremendous thing to do for my mother. So we were on board there. It didn't make it easier, to be clear. Like, this wasn't like we weren't.
I'll bet it was really difficult because, you know, you want to be around your wife to support her when she's pregnant, and here you had to be away, and she couldn't come with you because of her situation. So I bet that was really hard.
She had just started showing.
Aww.
For our first son.
Uh-huh.
And I remember when I got back, it was the day before her birthday. She was huge. And so my son was born.
She wasn't that big.
No, in like the best way. Like, you know, it's super cute. But, you know, a month later, our son was born.
Aww.
And so one of the great things, so my mother named my son.
She gave him,
yeah, so his name is Toluwanimi.
Uh-huh.
And it means I belong to God. It's a Yoruba name. And so so whenever we call my son, there's this connection between what just happened with the transplant, my son being born. And so there was a lot of celebration and
a lot of symbolism too, I think.
Yeah.
So looking back on all you know now, all the surprises that came up along the way,
yes.
Would you do it again in the same for the same person, for your mother?
I would do it again without a doubt. To be clear, like it was recovery was painful, right? Because I also had to travel 12 hours back home and things like that. So there was my circumstance was a little different.
Yes.
And with the baby on the way, there was a lot of like emotional, but I would do it again.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I would absolutely do it again.
So you mentioned a little bit earlier, you know, about how being a living donor has changed you. One of the things you mentioned was that you're more aware of your own personal health and ways to keep you healthy, which is actually a really good thing to have that kind of incentive.
Yeah.
Are there any other ways? Oh, you said that you really appreciate life and your sons and your wife a little bit more than maybe you would have.
My faith, more than
faith.
Any of that.
Yeah.
Because Elaine, what it does, it forces you to confront your, like, our morbidity as humans, right? Like, we are here for a finite time.
Yes.
I feel really awesome that I was able to play a part in my mom being here for 13 more years and we all get to enjoy her.
But hey, 13 going on 40.
More, yeah, absolutely, absolutely,
yeah.
Absolutely.
Uh-huh.
But what it has done is it's teaching me that there's something bigger.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that an organ can go from me to my mother, she has three kidneys now.
Yeah.
And it starts working.
Wow.
Like, I am filled with wonder. And so that allows me to, like, just pause and just be grateful. And that's a gift I received. And so I do not take for granted, I don't take many things for granted, even this conversation. Even the opportunity to invite others, that this is a big thing to help someone live. And so, yeah, absolutely, I would do it again. And it has made me a better human, a better person. Absolutely, yes.
That whole spiritual journey, that it's interesting to hear you talk about it, because I think as a recipient, I don't know how you could go through that process without having a spiritual journey along the way. And it's really a beautiful thing that as a donor, you even had that. That can only make you a more dynamic person going forward, you know?
There's something beautiful about giving gifts that enriches the giver also. And I would say to any recipient, like, it's an honor to be able to share that gift.
Aww.
You know, and so sometimes my mother would look at me and I could tell that she feels not bad that I had to do that,
mm-hmm.
but like...
So grateful.
So grateful.
So humbled, probably, too.
But it's an honor to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And like even just that as a reward, like it, not that we're doing it for rewards, but mm-hmm. it's an honor to share that.
You know, it's interesting because whenever you hear people talk about volunteerism, which you and I are both very pro-volunteer, you always are amazed that you volunteer to give, but you're always so amazed with what you get back. And it sounds like you had a very similar, if not deeper, experience with that.
Yes.
Because that's really the ultimate volunteer activity.
Yes.
Yeah.
And in a really, this might be not, I just want to be, I want to be clear when I say this. So I have a scar that reminds me of the event of the sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
And to use spiritual language, like, I know I will always be taken care of.
Aww. Mm-hmm.
Because I was asked to do something very difficult, and I said yes, and I believe that God, like, will take care of us,
mm-hmm.
me, my wife, and my children.
That's a beautiful feeling to have. So, I know you saw your mom probably within the last 3 years before
yes.
the pandemic. I
yes.
remember a big trip.
Yes.
What's it like seeing her now after all these years, so healthy and happy?
There are moments where it feels like we have like not an inside joke, but like an inside like experience, a shared experience.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was a wedding. My younger brother was getting married.
Okay.
And the Yoruba culture, we dress up.
Uh-huh.
And it's huge.
And it's very colorful.
Very colorful.
Uh-huh.
And it's a celebration. And there are these moments where I'm just like, oh, I'm so grateful that we could do this.
Mm-hmm.
So it was such
and
an amazing experience.
And your kids
experience.
Gotten to know her over the years. Now you have two boys.
Yep.
Yeah, that's really
yeah,
awesome.
Yeah, it's been really great. I don't know how much of the process they know about
uh-huh.
yet.
They'll know a lot more after this show. I'm yes. sure you're going to make them watch it.
Absolutely. They're on YouTube all the time. They might as well watch something useful. But yeah, it's been tremendous. And every time we see each other, there's this like...
Knowing. Yeah. That's
cool.
A beautiful thing.
Yeah. Really cool.
So is there any facet or any thought that you really want to make sure you get out into the world today? I know that you did not come on the show without me tugging at you a tiny bit because I know this is a very private thing for you, but I do so appreciate you sharing your story and helping people understand the process of living donation.
And I thank you. And this is the first time, I was telling my wife, this is the first time I've talked about this publicly.
Mm-hmm.
And it's because, well, you asked, and I can't say no to
it. And I'm very hard to resist.
Yes. But with, in all honesty, like, giving a gift, if I could invite folks to consider becoming a living donor,
mm-hmm.
This is... I would love to formally invite folks to consider it.
You're right over there.
I don't know where the camera is. But because yes, it's not an easy process.
Mm-hmm.
There are two things I want to make clear. you don't have to be excited about it to do this.
Mm-hmm.
It's a sacrifice, but it's also the gift of extended time on earth
right.
that you're giving to someone.
Right.
And then the second thing really quickly is just... It's worth it. It really is. Yes.
Well, I have two true or false questions I hope you're going to help me with today, Bala.
Okay.
Just to give out some more information. So, true or false, if you know a person that you would like to help through a living directed donation, which is what you did, you directly donated to somebody you knew, should you talk to him and her and contact the transplant program where the person is listed?
True, yes.
That is very true. In fact, I think I have a slide here that shows some of the transplant centers in our area. So you don't go to a place like Gift of Life to say, I want to be a living donor. If you know somebody and you want to try to donate to them, you go right to the center where they are going to be having their procedure. If you are just a really nice person, like somebody I know here in the BCTV studios, where you want to be wonderful to somebody that you don't know, or just you want to help in some way, then you can also go to any of these local donor facilities and let them know about your intentions. That's called a non-directed donor. So, my second question is, okay, if you would like to be a non-directed donor, you should contact a transplant hospital of your choice to find out if they have this type of donation program. True or false?
True.
That is also true.
Awesome.
You know your donations inside and out. So that is the trick. So if you know a person, you go directly to where they're having their transplant. If you want to do a non-directed donation, you go to just any one of the local places that might have shown above. So what I'm going to do is show you the following five programs that I'm going to be doing is going to have to do with organ donation. You know, putting yourself up as an organ donation in case you would pass. And there's no age limit to becoming an organ donator, because you can donate all kinds of different things in addition to your vital organ. So, Joan, if you wouldn't mind playing that short 37-second video, it tells you a little bit more on how to become an organ donor.
We don't have that right now.
Oh, you don't have that right now. Okay, that's fine too. So, basically what you do is when you go to get your driver's license, you can sign up at your driver's license facility, or you can also get a hold of www.donorone.com. That is the Gift of Life program, and they will have an area on their website that allows you to sign up in the big program until you get to get your driver's license a little bit later on. So, Bala, I want to thank you so much from the bottom of my heart for joining us tonight and sharing your beautiful story.
Thank you.
And
for having
thank
me.
You to all of you who stuck around and shared with us. I do want to put in a plug for BCTV going forward. October is our big Oktoberfest auction time. If you have a business or you have just an interest in helping BCTV support this awesome channel, then please drop by a donation here at our new studios at 401 Penn Street. If you have something but you'd like it to be picked up, you can give us a call, 610-374-3065, and we'll be glad to pick it up. And also remember to bid online starting at the beginning of October. So thanks again for joining us. We really appreciate it, and we'll see you soon. Bye-bye.
Did you know you can decide today to sign up on your state registry as an organ, eye, and tissue donor? Any age is the right age, starting in your teens. And any day is the right day to sign up as a donor. You can register when you get your driver's license, your learner's permit, or ID. Or you can sign up right now online. Remember to tell your family so they can support your wishes. Start now. Go to organdonor.gov and share the gift of life.